the Johnny Rocket Munch Pad. And now, here's Johnny!
Hey, it's Johnny Rocket here at the Johnny Rocket Launchpad, launching ideas in your direction, the Northwest's only rock and roll libertarian radio show. I'm here with my co-host, Mr. Kurt Nelson.
Fucking A, brother.
The beautiful Heather Nixon.
Hello.
And we're here with our very special guest, Mr. Mac Whirly.
Woo! How's it going?
All right, man, here we go. This is the part we've all been waiting for. We've been talking about this, and I think we should probably just explain this to the audience if they're not aware of what we're going to be talking about. It's called judicial review. And let's start off with, what is the significance of Marbury versus Madison case?
Okay, so, wow, okay, I'll start with this. By the way, stop me if I go too fast.
No, man, keep going.
I've explained this to, a couple times here, so I go fast, but... Anyway, so basically what had happened, it's the election after
John Adams.
John Adams, there we go. It's the election after John Adams had just lost to Thomas Jefferson. So, and right as he's about ready to leave office, John Adams writes these midnight appointments. And he's appointing people to justices of the peace. There are these, they're basically judges, is essentially what they are. So he writes these appointments out, and then he leaves them there on his desk, and Thomas Jefferson is supposed to give them to the people who had these political appointments, and they were supposed to have their positions. Well,
right.
Thomas Jefferson is really not liking John Adams at this time. They used to be best buddies. John Adams was Thomas Jefferson's mentor growing up, but there was some conflict.
One was a Federalist, and the other one was a Democratic Republican.
Yeah, well, Jefferson, he really was an anti-federalist. He was trying to keep small government and things like that. And from everything that I have been able to research, Adams was actually like Washington, and he wasn't trying to play the party politics. And he felt betrayed by Jefferson when Jefferson essentially started running against him for the presidency as an anti-federalist while he was sitting as John Adams's vice president. So
okay.
He felt betrayed. So, and now that leads to this big conflict, and Thomas Jefferson and Adams hate each other at this point. So
mm-hmm.
When Jefferson takes office, he's not going to make these political appointments that Adams made because he doesn't like them. And these are the other side. These people are from the other party, basically. And he wanted to not have those people in there. Anyway, one of those guys, his name was Marbury, and
okay.
Marbury, he walks into the Secretary of State's office, who was James Madison, and he says, "Hey, what's going on?" James Madison had been instructed by Jefferson to not give those appointments out, so Marbury made a federal case about it, literally, and took it to the Supreme Court because there was a law out. It was a judicial act that was passed by Congress that required the executive branch to actually fulfill these appointments. But there's nowhere in the Constitution that gives them the legal authority to do that. The Congress can't tell the executive to do that kind of thing. It's nowhere in their job description. It's
okay.
Not in the Constitution. So,
okay, you're right.
Anyway, Chief Justice John Marshall, he recognized this, that it was not in the Constitution for that law. And he also recognized that if he said that Jefferson was in violation of this law, Jefferson could just ignore him because there's no force behind the Supreme Court. They have no army. They don't have any armed guards that can storm in and make you do what they say. They require the other branches to listen to them. And this was a contentious issue at a contentious time. And even John Marshall was not on friendly terms with Jefferson because John Marshall was the Secretary of State for Adams.
So he was a Federalist also.
Exactly. So Jefferson, he didn't care what this guy said. So basically what John Marshall, being a really smart guy, he basically used this as a situation to gain more power instead of looking weak. Instead of making the Supreme Court look weaker, he used it to gain power. He actually coined the term judicial review. He gave them the ability to determine whether or not things are constitutional or not by saying that he can't do anything about the situation because the law itself is unconstitutional. Therefore, it is repugnant and should be null and void. And he voided out a law basically doing that. In that, he created the whole idea, the whole concept that the Supreme Court can be the ultimate arbiter on all things constitutional. And this is a power that was never given to the Supreme Court. They just took it.
Interesting.
So basically, it was kind of an overstep of the of John Marshall, in a sense. I mean, you can agree with it or disagree with judicial review if that is the Supreme Court's job. Regardless, he overstepped his boundaries in his constitutional contract, more or less.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, it depends on, it's all interpretation. At this point, you're asking about things that were never set up in the framework. So this is a total change in the framework. And it doesn't matter what anyone says, it's an opinion, whether or not it's from a federal judge or from just Joe Schmo on the street. That's an opinion.
Okay, so the ultimate question is, our government is supposed to be consisted of checks and balances. It's, you know, obviously that was the intent, that every branch could check the other branch if they were doing something wrong. What power does the rest of the government have against the judicial branch? What power, what checks do they have on them?
Right now, I mean, for the fact of judicial review, there is no check and balance with any of the other branch currently. There is nothing right now that any branch can do, any kind of recourse. If the Supreme Court says something is constitutional or unconstitutional, they have the final say. They're the ultimate arbiter, and there's no way around it right now. And that is not the way that the system of checks and balances was supposed to have been created. The only thing that we can do, short of an act of Congress, seriously, to get those guys out of there is to actually impeach them for some kind of criminal offense. That's all we can do. They have to literally, you know, commit treason or break the law in some way for us to get them out of there.
Wow. But see, here's the thing. You know, there's the case that there could have been over 200 years now of judges declaring things unconstitutional or constitutional or whatever that haven't been challenged whatsoever for the last 200 years, basically.
Exactly. And I mean, and there's no, right now within the framework, there is no way to answer that. You know, and we have talked about different solutions. Personally, I am a big fan of checks and balances. I love the framework that our founders set up for us, the original framework. It gave a real good balance, in my opinion, between the federal government, the state governments, the judicial branch, executive branch, the Congress, and in addition to that, individuals. I mean, even here as individuals, we were a check and a balance in more than one way. Through number one, we vote people into office. So, you know, if we're electing strong leaders, we are in control of that. That is a check and a balance.
Right.
If somebody is going off the rails, we can vote them out of office. But in addition to that, an area that people don't really know a whole lot about is jury nullification. We have the authority and the ability to nullify a law, even if it's passed and the Supreme Court says it's good to go. All the other branches say it's good to go. It requires people to convict you. So if us as individual citizens decide that a law is unconstitutional, we don't have to convict somebody for an unjust law.
Okay, what are some things that we could do, though? I mean, we were talking about a possible judicial reform amendment where, you know, maybe we could get the state legislators to, you know, vote a decision that the Supreme Court constitutes as unconstitutional, and they could reverse that decision based on, you know, majority or supermajority of the state legislators. So it's not the same people. It's not the federal. It's not the House of Representatives and the Senate, the federal Senate. It's actual legislation from the states themselves.
And for that, you know, we're talking about judicial reform in this regard. So it's basically adding a check and a balance, making it so that the Supreme Court isn't the ultimate arbiter. So and what we have now is a circumstance where the Congress passes a law and it has to go through both houses, which is the Senate and the House of Representatives, and then the president has an opportunity to veto, so that's a check and a balance there. And then if something happens, somebody gets prosecuted and they're questioning the constitutionality, they can appeal it all the way up to the Supreme Court, and if the Supreme Court wants to see it or hear the case, they can determine whether or not that is constitutional or not. We need to add another layer to that to make them not the ultimate say on whether something is constitutional, and give the power back to the states, as you were saying. And for me, this all kind of clicked when I was reading Mark Levin's Liberty Amendments. You know, this is his kind of plan. So I think that what would need to be added to create a check and a balance on the Supreme Court is, number one, we got to give them term limits. They sit for life right now. These people are unelected appointees who sit for life, and there's nothing that we can do to get rid of them other than impeach them or wait until they die or resign.
They're there for life. You're like, we're fucked. We got Jim over here, and he's a total dick.
Yeah.
And because Reagan put him in an office in 1989, and now we're fucked because he's still sitting there.
Well, but has anybody compiled a list of arguments? Like, wait a minute, this was considered constitutional, yet it's not. Oh, here's another example of something that was considered constitutional,
well, sure, yet it's not. I'll give you a couple examples right now. You know, awesome. Slavery was endorsed by the Supreme Court. This is why I don't have any real highly, I don't really think highly of these people because, first of all, they endorsed slavery. They said that segregation was totally constitutional. And then they said that the internment of Japanese Americans, and we're not just talking about a couple, we're talking about thousands of Japanese Americans were ripped from their homes during World War II and sent into internment camps, basically prison camps, and they didn't do anything wrong. Just the fact that they were, their family had a certain heritage, they were locked up. This was approved by the Supreme Court. This is totally constitutional.
Okay. A little bit of a review. You were saying something about FDR and during the New Deal and how he was saying that, I think you were saying that the Supreme Court were saying, hey man, this is unconstitutional, and he threatened them?
Yeah, it's they call it the change that saved the nine, I think is what it goes. But yeah, basically he said that he was going to pack the court. He said he was going to add, I think it was up to 15 judges total and get his way because they weren't doing what he wanted. So he was just going to, and again, those are people that he gets to appoint. So he would just pack the court and then he would be able to get his way. But they changed their mind and they started approving his New Deal legislation. And that was kind of where things took off.
Through coercion, more or less.
Exactly. I mean, he literally twisted their arm and they had to comply. Otherwise, they were going to be useless. In terms of the judicial review, I'm sorry, the judicial reform, you know, obviously they need term limits. I believe that they should get, 12-year term limits. That gives them mm-hmm. one full 8-year presidency and then another 4 years of another one. So I think that's plenty of time.
Okay.
In addition to that, the states need to have a say. We are sadly lacking in state sovereignty with the 17th Amendment. It has eliminated the voice of the states and the government. It basically made it so that citizens vote for our senators in the federal Congress, which is, that used to be done through the states.
Our state legislation was the ones who appointed our own senators.
So I'm for repealing the 17th Amendment, but in addition to that, I think that the states, if we get 3/4 majority of all of the states who determine that a ruling is unconstitutional that the Supreme Court has made, they can mm-hmm. overturn it. We need a way to overturn the Supreme Court. And in addition to that, I think there should probably be some time limits on that. Like, you shouldn't be able to go back, indefinitely through time. You know, it should be, you can only go back like 3 years or something like that, to where as long as if we get a new president in office, they're not basically undoing everything that the last one did.
Right on. How about Oath Keepers, man? What is that organization all about? You know, we've talked about it briefly, but you are actually a member of Oath Keepers. Why don't you talk to us about that organization?
I've been a chapter member of the Oath Keepers out here, but the Oath Keepers in general, they're just a group of patriots, people who love liberty, a lot of different backgrounds, but they all swore an oath to support and defend the Constitution. Some of them are military, some of them are law enforcement, some of them are firefighters, government officials, things along those lines. And some are just civilians who swore the oath because they feel passionate about it. And, that they will uphold the Constitution from all enemies, foreign and domestic. Mm-hmm. And in addition to that, they try to educate the people about the Constitution. And actually also, and I think this is really important, try to educate our current law enforcement officers and military about the Constitution that they swore an oath to, and try to get them to also join that group and that movement to actually support this document.
You know, and if you're an Oath Keeper, I think any of those guys would have no objection to like wearing a camera. I think it's in the best interests of everyone because they're a public servant. And we've had this discussion here on the Launchpad regarding that because, you know, I think it's important that cops are public servants. They're not, you know, obviously they're not taking their camera at home, you know, where they still have their privacy, but it's their duty to society to uphold the law and enforce the law. And I don't think they would object to it. I don't think, you think the Oath Keepers would object to wearing cameras?
If you're asking if they would wear cameras in their homes or something?
No. Yeah, no, I'm saying when they're on duty, if you're on duty, because not only does it protect them, it protects the individual.
Yeah, I know. I agree with that. If you're talking about on duty or something, I guess it would depend on who it is. This is one of those things where it's actually a contentious issue, that the body cameras, because it could be used to collect more data, which they can go back and use computer algorithms to find all the license plates that guy saw on a given day. So, I mean, there's people on both sides of it that, you know, you want police accountability, but also you want to maintain privacy as much as possible and respect the individual citizens. So that's one of those contentious issues. But oddly enough, you know, you're talking about the actual, like, like transparency of an organization. Yeah. You know, that we're talking about the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court is the most, it's the least transparent organization that there are. And oddly enough, I was just looking at a recent poll not too long ago. They were ranked higher than any of the other branches that have more transparency. And we elect that. I think Congress had a 7% approval rating, and then it was like 10% or something for the president.
Right.
And it was 23% rating for the Supreme Court. And most people don't even know who these people are, let alone even have they ever even seen inside the courtroom, because there's no cameras allowed unless you smuggle them in. There's only like two photographs in history that have ever been taken in one video that has ever been taken.
Is that why you have like the sketch artists?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
And that chick with the typewriter.
I think she has a name, but I mean, that chick with the typewriter will do.
Stenographer.
There you go.
Oh, thank you. Yeah. The chick with the typewriter.
They literally, have outlawed this to where, you know, that you go through security and you can't bring a camera into a public space to record officials performing public duties. They're on duty. These are public officials. All of this is public. Mm-hmm. We own this, but they control it and say it's their courtroom.
We need to have like a television crew.
Yeah, that's bullshit.
Bullshit.
The craziest part about that, though, is that they, you know, these decisions that these people make affect every one of us in the country. So it's not like it's just something that's not that big of a deal.
It's not affecting Jimbo over there in Alabama. It's affecting everybody. Real quick, does the president have the right to make executive orders? Now, I've heard it's been going on for, I don't know how many years it's been going on, but from my understanding, executive orders could only affect people within the executive branch. When you give an executive order, that's the scope of the executive power.
Now, again, you know, this is all going to come down to opinion and it's interpretation. So you'll have federal judges interpret things differently. But my personal opinion is that, you know, based off of what I have read about George Washington, he was the one that started the executive orders. He was using it for internal stuff within the executive branch.
And that's what they said. It was cool.
Right. Mm-hmm. It was okay there.
And the problem is that they, you know, everything is based off of interpretation and precedent. So somebody got away with something else and somebody got away with something else. And then it eventually went on and on and on. And what will happen is what we see today, you know, oh, well, the last guy did it, so I should be able to.
I'm with you. I just think it's ridiculous. I think it's overstepping. Congress is the only one who should make laws, period. I mean, I think we should try to stick to the original intent. And some people will argue the intent. And sometimes the intent is, or it's skewed, it's distorted, especially through Hamiltonian viewpoints or nationalist viewpoints versus a anti-federalist viewpoint.
Mm-hmm.
And so you have two sides of the aisle. They'll say, well, no, Hamilton said it this way. But people are like, fuck Hamilton. He was a goddamn monarchist. And then other people are saying, well, no. George Mason and Patrick Henry saw it from this perspective. Well, okay, well, who ultimately really won? The Federalists did, which we created this national government and slowly became more and more nationalized as time progressed.
And, you know, the anti-Federalists, I think they'd be rolling over in their graves considering, you know, they made all these compromises and they thought that they put checks and balances in to prevent it from growing and growing. But, you know, it wasn't enough. In my opinion, I'm a fan of no law. Really, I don't really like new laws, except for the ones that actually restrict our government. I think we've got enough laws that restrict us now. Let's restrict the crap out of our government.
Yeah. More. I'm all for more negative laws, what they can't do to us.
What's a negative law?
A negative law is something where you have a right to do something, but the federal government or state government cannot interfere with you. So I have the freedom of speech. Therefore, I am protected from them fucking with me for saying fuck. Whereas a positive law would be, I have a right to a fair trial. The government, therefore, is obligated to provide me a fair trial. It's an action on their part, where a negative law is an inaction.
Yeah, because that's just confusing.
Well, no, like all of our rights, like freedom of speech, right to bear arms, all those things, the basic fundamental ones, all are pretty much negative laws. Positive laws are what the government can do. What have you done for me lately?
Eddie!
It's all positive laws. Mac, do you have a problem with that?
Actually, you know, I like the idea of more negative laws, you know, and as far as...
I am too.
Negative
Leave
laws
me
for
alone.
The government. Yeah, I want them bogged down with red tape, and that's the way it's supposed to be. You know, the government's supposed to be slow. It's supposed to be, you know, a very long process to get anything done, because our founders were very, very concerned about the metaphor, a man on a white horse, and they thought that George Washington was, because he literally was riding around on a white horse.
But, literally was a man on a white horse, right?
Yeah. Like,
whiskey were betting and they all over white horse. Get the fuck out of here.
They were afraid of like a Julius Caesar kind of repeat where, you know, the army would fight for this guy more than they were fighting for their country. And it, you got to imagine, too, this is at the beginning of the country. There was so much concern that will this country last? You know, do we have loyalty to the country or loyalty to the people? And that was why Washington really was the indispensable man. He had already given up power once. And in fact, I think it was, if I'm remembering, I think it's King Henry. Is that the king that was in charge during the revolution? Anyway, whoever it was, he said that if George Washington gives up his power, he'd be the best man in the world, essentially, is what I'm paraphrasing it. And he did.
It was King George, wasn't it? King George III?
Yeah, maybe it was. I can't remember. I don't pay attention to English.
Fuck those
history.
Brits. Right. But, sorry, Robin Kerner.
Oh, sorry. Blue Republican. Check him out, everybody.
Wait, isn't he an American now?
He might be.
Well, a citizen.
What'd you say? Oh, my God. Don't say that. We're going to get slammed by the PC police.
Brown bag.
Shit.
Anyways, hey, it's Johnny Rocket here at the Johnny Rocket Launchpad, launching ideas in your direction, the Northwest's only rock and roll libertarian radio show. Stick around. We got more of Mac Whirly on Rocket Fire, and then what we have up next is A Woman's Place. So stick around.
This is Austin Peterson from the Libertarian Republic. You're listening to the Johnny Rocket Launchpad.